The following content is provided under a Creative Commons license. Your support will help MIT OpenCourseWare continue to offer high-quality educational resources for free. To make a donation or view additional materials from hundreds of MIT courses, visit MIT OpenCourseWare at ocw.mit.edu.
All right, so you just want me to start? All right, so today we're here to tell you guys a little bit about our first research project on a dynamical system that we refer to as the n-value game. The n-value game is best understood by first an example. Basically, you put points on a plane, so we'll label these points 0, 3, 6, and 3. You form the regular polygon connecting these points. And then for each pair of vertices, we're going to take the absolute difference between the adjacent vertices and put that in the middle. Okay? So for this one up here, we have 0 minus 3. The absolute value is 3. On this one, we have 3. Here, we have 3. And over here, again, we have 3. Okay. And then at this point, we're just going to iterate the process. So here we see the difference is 0, 0, 0, and 0. So this is a quick example of a game converging to the fixed point 0, 0, 0. But at this point, it's really sort of important that we generalize the definitions of how we're going to represent this n value game. So first of all, we want to define what we mean by a state. Okay, so a state, call it S, is some vector of numbers, and we'll specify the set that we choose it from, but in the general case, it can be from any set of numbers. And their index is 0, 8, 1, 2, and their sum is. The length of S is then n. So in this example here, we have S, actually we have the initial state, S sub 0, is equal to, by convention we start in the top left and go counterclockwise. So we have 0, 3, 6, and 3. So we see that this is an example of the four value game. Okay. Now, in order to transition in between states, like we did here with the green square, we need to define what we mean by a transition. Okay. So, in the general case, we have the transition rule T that operates on a given state S. And T of S gives the absolute difference between the adjacent vertices. So this is going to be carried out. Okay. Now at this point, the last definition we need is the notion of a game. Now a game, going to be the collection of the states with this operator on it. So we have some state S0, and then we have the operator T on S0 gives us state S1. And then T of S1 gives us S2, and so forth. And this collection of sets of the set of states is our game. One of the immediate questions we see is, how can we quantify sort of the size of the game? Or is there a size of the game? You know, will this sequence always converge like it did here? Or is it possible to have non-repeating games, cycles, and so forth? So the next thing we want to talk about is the long-term behavior of the game. Okay. So in terms of long-term So in order to quantify what exactly we mean by a cycle, we want to define the notion of a k-cyclic gain. So a k-cyclic gain is a gain such that there exists integers m and k, and k is the smallest of such integers, such that t to the m plus k on the initial state is equal to t to the m on the initial state. So in our example up there, we see that games can be one cyclic. Now, that just means that we've converged to the fixed point, 0, 0, 0, or another fixed point. Later on in the talk, we're going to sort of venture into what fixed points we can converge to, but for now, we just need the notion of a k-cyclic game. Now, the other option, which would just be the opposite of k-cyclic, would be a non-repeating game. So in the non-repeating case, we'll just have that there doesn't exist any such k. So if we have some state 0, and we operate on it, s1, this sequence will never converge. Okay. Are there any questions at this point with the definitions? No? Okay. So in order to investigate this long-term behavior for different scenarios of the n value game, we also need to define what we mean by equivalence. So in terms of talking about states, we want to be able to take some state S, which has these values, and ask the question, we have S and then say V is equal to some other state. And then we want to ask the question, does S equal to V? Okay. So one of the first things that we notice in terms of this transition rule is the basic properties of subtraction that we can abstract from it. The first thing that we can do is add an offset. So if we say that we want to add an offset k, which is a vector of the same constant over and over and over. So we take the offset state, which is s naught plus k. So we get a0 plus k, a1 plus k, and then we operate on this offset state. So when we scale a state k, or a state s, we choose some number r that's greater than 0, and we write that rs is equal to r a0. And then we want to look at what happens when we apply the transition rule to this modified, the scaled state S. So if we write out the first term, RA0 minus RA1, given that we chose R greater than 0, R is not going to affect this, and we can pull the R out. Which means that t of rs is equal to the constant r times t of s. We have four numbers. And then we look at the first transition, so t of s. So the point is that any time we permute the elements, our vertices, about the four different places, as long as we preserve the two adjacent vertices, our state after the operator is effectively the same. Okay? So in this example, we see in the top row that we are simply shifting counterclockwise. So these four games are immediately obvious that they're the same, because we could have just changed our convention to say, okay, we're gonna start at the bottom left, and then our state is the same. These ones are a little trickier because we're actually rotating the vertices about some symmetry of the square. Not rotating, we're flipping the vertices, sorry. So we're flipping the vertices about some symmetry of the square. But as we showed here, as long as it maintains the same adjacent neighbors, it will be unchanged. So in this example, we see that the vertex A is adjacent to B and D. And then when we flip about this vertical line of symmetry, A is adjacent to D and B. So in order to generalize this, we refer to sigma as a permutation of the vertices about the dihedral of 2n. But the point is that for any state S0, as long as we take a permutation of it from this dihedral group, we will have the same long-term behavior of the game. So at this point, we want to formally put it all together and define our notion of the vertices. So we say that two states, X and Y, are equivalent if and only if there exists an R greater than 0, a constant vector K, and a permutation of the dihedral group such that R sigma X plus K is equal to 1. So two states are equal if and only if we can apply any of these three properties that preserve the state's behavior, long-term behavior in the game. That will result in two equal states. So at this point, I'm going to pass over to Yida so we can talk about the three guys.
Just a minor thing, that S0 should be any state in the case of game.
This one?
Not specifically the starting state. Just there has to be a state for which this is true.
Yeah, and later on, you actually at the top of the board there, you have an S, and then you start using S0. So you're sort of schizophrenic about whether you want to say S0 or S. And I'm on the S side.
I agree. Well, S0 really only exists if we bound the size of the max integer array.
Well
I'm saying
it's saying I have in mind other states.
Yeah.
So I'm going to call this one S0.
Yeah.
So it makes sense if you're going to talk about Sn.
But in this case, it doesn't matter if it's the initial state.
Exactly. I mean, so you have the game in mind, so you do have that, but the whole sequence in mind. For my money, focusing on the state of T of S is...
Which means, so in that one I did it, but in this one I went back to...
It's just one less bit of mutation. So. I really like your sort of demeanor. You're welcoming and relaxed and engaged kind of conversation, and you look us in the eye and you often when you're talking, that's really, it's a great. I wish instructors would do that in that department.
They're more focused on the board.
So So if, when, and I think that the board work is terrific too. I'm learning something about what students like in board work from watching you guys at the board. Like dividing the board in three parts with a headline on each of the three parts is something that I've actually never seen before all of the presentations in this, before this term, when all the presentations have adopted that convention. Maybe it's because you've seen it in other presentations in the course. Or maybe it's just what you want and it's the right thing to do.
It depends, because I would say in the case of 1803 lectures, I remember you wrote, first of all, about five times larger than that, and
well,
used
that's 'cause the room
all
is five times.
Right. But that's my point. Is I think that this is only sort of applicable in the case where the room is this deep. I would want to write much larger if it was deeper.
Okay, the writing is perfectly apt. It's clear.
Okay.
Aaron, I thought this was really cool to have this shrinking set of polygons and then fill them in and talk about the game is filling them in. So they pre-existed earlier and you fill them in as a cool, just expository device. Then in the definition of state here, it's A0, A1, and so on, dot, 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 and the length of S is N, but what's N?
So I said it, but I guess I didn't write it. I was saying that this N is N.
So you could sort of connect those two lines by writing after the dot dot dot, like a sub n minus one.
Yeah.
And then it would complete the.
Okay.
And I think that's going to be important in the definition of the transition, because there's the question of what happens in the last place.
The wraparound. I thought about that when I was writing.
So then this goes on, it's all cool, like this. And then long-term behavior. So definition of K cyclic game, there exists N and K, but K already is there. It's the K in the word K cyclic. So we're not saying now there exists something. We already have the K.
Okay.
But you do want to say there's an N. And then what you said but didn't write was the K is supposed to be the minimal.
Mm-hmm.
That's arguable. That's a choice you can make. I mean, so when Yida talks, he can't say that every game is 3-7. Every three value game is 3-7.
Right.
Some two of them are not. I mean, one collection of them are not. They're 1-7.
Mm-hmm.
So you just have to be careful about making that choice of a minimal cycle. I'm not sure I'd say converge. So you were saying that that non-repeating means it never converges.
Mm-hmm.
But Matt is going to show us a game that converges to something.
Yeah. Okay.
Doesn't maybe stabilize, doesn't become constant. There are a lot of other words to use besides converge.
Okay.
So I guess part of what I'm doing is being really picky about words.
Okay.
Use it in language. Then you started to talk about equivalence, and I actually missed the rationale that you had for moving to thinking about equivalence.
So I said that it was important when we discussed the long-term behavior specifically of the four-value game. Because the idea of equivalence is how we prove that the four-value
right, so now I know that's the case, but it didn't...
It wasn't loud enough.
Yeah, it's... It wasn't really effective to the audience because who knows how that's going to show up in that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sure we can find a way to motivate it. But it needs to be something that isn't sort of forward referential.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, this gets to a bigger comment that I have about, so I tend to usually focus on how to make the talk engaging.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the first part of it is really good. Over here, though, it started to get where my eyes were kind of getting over, and it would have been You could have motivated by saying one of your questions is, how long is the game? Like you didn't, or I missed.
We didn't say that because
that's a conscious decision.
We had talked about not really going into that.
Right, that's just
in
something
the talk
that
because
talk
we thought it was more interesting to talk about non-repeating games.
I agree. So we have to find some rationale. But the non-repeating thing, this equivalence is going to come up. So.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
so even so, it could be motivated by saying, by going back to this one and drawing an equivalent game and observing that the behavior is going to be the same. And then asking, so what is this notion of equivalence? When will two games have the same behavior? And then you can go into the three. And the three, I wonder whether you could do them, introduce the idea of offset scaling and symmetry by picture, by example, first.
Mm-hmm.
As a way to make it more engaging. And then you might not even need to formalize, but you could quickly formalize once people get the idea like that from seeing that picture.
So everything about communication is subject to controversy and different opinions. And
because the audience varies.
It's
like
various.
There are different kinds of people in the audience.
I would take the other point of view and say that this is the clearest thing to say when you want to talk about scaling and the offset. I mean, I didn't feel I needed an example for this, although I'm not a people man. But I thought this was fun. One of the things you said is when is S equal to V? And you actually wrote it there in the upper right hand board. I mean, I know the answer to that. It's when A0 equals B0.
Okay. It should be three lines.
So, yeah, I mean, and then later you very carefully wrote it with three lines.
Yes.
So, at least you have to be consistent,
mm-hmm.
and I would advocate for three lines.
Well, yeah, they're not equal unless all the elements are the same.
Then the most subtle one, this dihedral group thing, you didn't want to get into the a little more detail about
mm-hmm.
why the dynamics are the same. By the way, one other thing to say about motivating, you can just say, we're interested in the long-term behavior of these games. And so, and in studying that, it's useful to understand when two different games have the same long-term behavior.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to define a notion of equivalence between games with the property that equivalent games have the same long-term behavior.
Right.
And then go on from that.
Okay.
I think that would be convincing to people that's not to hear. So for this equivalence thing, I got this sort of hand-wavy feeling about the dihedral group.
Well, I realized when I was writing it that I wasn't sure how to explain it outside of saying I understand it, which
so one thing
I know
is one thing you can say is that if you take T sigma S, that's equal to some other permutation applied to TS.
Mm-hmm.
It's not sigma TS, except when you have a rotation to that.
Mm-hmm.
But it's some other dihedral permutation.
So should we do like a sigma and a sigma prime?
Something you could actually say that.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, that would be.
That's good.
Even I'm talking about this, actually automorphism, the symmetrical, the dihedral group comes into play. It's kind of cool, but maybe not something pretty tough. But whenever you get uneasy about something because you know there's something that you're trying not to say. It comes across like water to the
audience.
It's just, there's nothing you can do to disguise that.
Okay.
So to make a resolution, it seems like you should decide what the, what is it about and what kind of part of speech is about. And
preposition.
Is it prepositions? You have to decide on your preposition. I would say that permutation is you said sigma's a permutation about the dihedral group, and then you said a permutation of the dihedral group. And what I would say is that a permutation is in the dihedral group.
Okay.
Just to be a proposition.
That makes sense. So after what Zach said, you guys probably are thinking about maybe, you know, why don't we consider this game over rational numbers, right, and not just integers. But I will quickly prove a corollary that says that all of the rational games can be reduced to integer games. So, okay, so the corollary basically states that all rational games can be reduced to integer games over over positive integers. And so the way we prove this is to actually use something that Zach talked about in the end of his talk, which related to the equivalence of different games. And so I'm going to start off by quickly giving a game or a state that is rational. So consider you have a state such as this, which, as you can see, is obviously rational, right? So the way we transform this into, or reduce this into an integer game, is we find a common denominator for this state, and then essentially pull out that common denominator to outside of this state in order to come up with a game over integers. So the common denominator we're going to use is just going to be a product of all of the denominators in here. And so this game, or the state, sorry, is equal to 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. And so we can, according to Zach's, the end of Zach's presentation, where he said that this state is equivalent to one in which a fixed value, in this case 1 over d, can be pulled out. So the scalar that we pulled out, this 1 over d, doesn't affect the end behavior of this state, right? So as you can see, we've just reduced a state over rational numbers into 1 over integers, positive integers, and it has the same behaviors as the rational game, or the rationals. Yeah, the rational state, S. Okay? So, a three-value game is one in which you're dealing with essentially a triangle, and as I put up here, the values are 1, 3, and 5, the initial state. And so, Zach, how would, so, Zach, how does this go? This would just be 2, right? And then
2, 4, 4.
And you just continue this 0, 2, 2, 2, 2, 0, 0, 2, 2. So And in the case of this game, which I randomly picked, you can see that there's going to be a cycle of the form 0 to 2. And it's what we call a 3 cycle. Because this game is going to cycle in this form. Until it goes back to the original state. And so this is just an example of a three value game. And we're going to look at the end behavior of these games. So I wanted to first give out some definitions. So the range is going to be just the largest positive difference between any two values in a three value game. So so write this down. So does anybody have any questions about this definition? Nope. And so we have to also talk about trivial three-value games versus non-trivial three-value games. So a trivial so does anybody can anybody tell me what a trivial three-value game would look like, or have any idea?
0, 0, 0.
Right, so in all these games, we want to just, the point is to find a way to go from your starting state to 0, 0, 0, right? For three-value game, or for four-value game, it would be 0, 0, 0, 0, as Zach mentioned. So a trivial game would be one where the start state, you know, would look like this. All of the values are the same, right? And this is trivial because on the next step, all of the new values are going to be 0, 0, 0, right? And so, consequently, a non-trivial non-trivial three-value game is one in which you have a transition. The first transition of the game leads you to something that isn't 0, 0, 0. So the proof that we're going to give is going to state that all three-value games, all non-trivial three-value games are going to cycle with a three, are going to have a three cycle. And this proof is going to be by cases. So I'm going to give all the different cases that are possible. And there are only 5 of them. And since all the states that we can have, they only depend on the adjacencies of the points, we only have to look at five different cases to outline all the possible states of a game. So there's going to be 5 cases, and I'm going to also list the states of these cases, and any of the assumptions, and any changes to the range, okay? So the first case, first of all, is there any questions before I go through the five cases quickly? No? Okay. So the first case, the state is this. So all these states are prior to a transition. So all the cases here, you'll see this is going to be the state before we do a transition by multiplying initial state by, or this the state by t. So there isn't going to be any assumptions in this with this case. And the range, as you can see, is not going to decrease. And so this is not going to change. Let's say zero. And so in this state is this first state, the first case that I'm listing is essentially the three cycle case, right? So once you get into this state, you're going to have a three cycle. And the example over there shows the example of the case one. And then case two is when you have two zeros and a positive integer. And there's no assumptions here, and also the range doesn't change. And so in this case, you will transition into case one, because you have zero minus x, and then x minus zero. So you're going to transition into case one. And so these are the three of the more, I'd say, trivial cases. And the next two cases are the ones that are more interesting. So in case four, the state is x, y, z, where x, y, and z are different values, different positive integers. And without loss of generality, we can assume that z is greater than y is greater than x. And we can assume this because essentially the three-value game is a game where you have values on a number line. And we can permute the values in the number line as, you know, as much as we want in order to reach a state that satisfies this condition where the third value is greater than the second value, which is greater than the first value. And so it's okay that we make this assumption. And if we make this assumption, we can see that the range will always decrease. And it will decrease by either y minus x or by z minus y, depending on the difference between y and z and x and y. Okay? And then the final case is when the state is 0x1. And again, we're going to make an assumption that y is greater than x. And in this case, what do you think the change in the range will be? So it will decrease by y minus the minimum of y minus x and x. And this is true because, you know, y, the range is the largest positive difference, right? And since y is the largest number, it's obviously going to be part of the calculation for the change in the range. So y is a large number, and you want to subtract it by the smallest of the state after the transition, which is going to be either y minus x or just x. Okay. So again, in this case, the range decreases. And so these are the five different cases that you may have. And for all non-trivial three-value games, the range is guaranteed to either stay the same. As you can see, it would stay the same in cases 1 through 3. And if that is if the range stays the same, then you know that the game is going to transition, the state is going to transition into a three cycle. Okay? And if the game doesn't go into case 1, 2, or 3, but rather 4 and 5, then the range is guaranteed to decrease, as I've shown. And if the range is to decrease, then after a finite number of decreases, there's going to be a repeated value in the game. So the game will essentially reach case 3, and once the game reaches case 3, then it's going to cycle. So covering all the different cases for a three-value game, we've proven that all non-trivial three-value games will cycle.
So in Zach's presentation, he didn't really talk about where the numbers were taken. He didn't talk about whether it was real or integers or stuff like that. He gave examples from integers, and I guess people had in their mind that maybe there was something. So maybe what you were doing here was making a transition to thinking about other possible values. Mm-hmm.
Well, that was actually my fault. Because we had discussed yesterday, like I was supposed to specifically like mention that we're talking about like the different sets of
the difference between different
right that we're like well I mentioned it very briefly, but I didn't mention that we're like restricting ourselves to positive value things, which is important, and so that was a point that I didn't touch on enough.
Well, maybe it's something that Yida should come back to.
Touch on more.
Regardless, yeah, I should probably mention or make it more explicit.
Bringing that out at some point makes some sense. Although, I didn't somehow the
transition from that to the.
Yeah, I wasn't really persuaded that the Q game story, because we hadn't thought about the different possible values of games, I wasn't very impressed with the fact that Q games have the same dynamics as integer games. I didn't have the background to make that connection. And really, it is a corollary. It's very strange to call something a corollary when you don't have any theorems on it. It's a corollary, but what is the question that you ask? But it is an easy consequence of the equivalence that Zach had already drawn out. So easy that I'm not sure it's really worthwhile spending a lot of time on it.
In fact, maybe you could just very briefly say this.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of the paper, it fits into like what I was talking about. I think we just divided it up that way because we weren't sure about time.
Yeah, yeah.
And we wanted to be more like third-wise. But in terms of like flow, I feel like it makes more sense to occur right after I talk about it.
Yeah, that's fine.
And just say this is like a quick consequence and just write it much faster.
You don't even have to go into all that detail.
Just say there is a common denominator. It can be pulled out.
Right. So that would bring out. And then there's the point of restricting to positive or non-negative is actually the word to say values, which is it's a comment that you can make also. There after the first step, you might as well just start there. And there's no loss of anything. And it just seems more natural to begin with. We're going to get there right away. But on the other hand, the work that you did here with this three game is all about Z value games, isn't it? Z plus value games.
Yeah.
So that was another thing that threw me off here, because when you said this initial stuff, I thought, oh, now we're going to start hearing about games with different values than Z, and then you go back and start talking about Z value games.
We could talk about Q, but then Q is the same as Z.
You'll see Q will be the same as Z, but R will be different. That's one. And actually that fact that R is different,
talk about well ordering,
Q is not different, that that makes this more interesting. So in a way, after Matt gives his spiel, that maybe would be a time to bring up the fact that there's a big difference between the reals and the cube, even though they don't look very different when you look at them as numbers.
Yeah.
Where you allow beings to take values makes a huge difference in the dynamics. That's kind of a cool thing to come back to. Yeah. So in and then later on you used these, where is it? You really used this notion of equivalence that Zach had set up, but without mentioning it, you called it various different things. Equivalent, can be reduced to is something you said. When what you really meant was it's equivalent to, in the sense that Zach had just developed.
Mm-hmm.
So I felt there was a disconnect between the two, between your presentation and Zach's, because you weren't picking up the language which you carefully introduced. It was ready for you to use.
Correct.
Another disconnect was you decided to have your states begin with A1, and Zach decided to have his states begin with A0. But anyway, consistency is what I'm looking at.
I
should have changed that in my notes.
So then I'm looking at this star data thing here, and it's kind of great because it disappears from view. It drills into the blackboard and disappears. But the downside of that is that it disappears. So, but actually, I guess I was busy writing here, because what I didn't notice is that you did write out the sequence of states that occur here. So that resolves the problem that I was kind of.
But you can also take the whole board. You can make that bigger.
Okay.
Could have, but I think that I was going to complain that you couldn't see what's going on. But you wrote out the states here, so I'm wrong. You could see that. That's a really important series of vectors to account for.
Okay. I'll keep that.
But you said, this is what we call a three-cycle, like you're kind of, what's the word? It's like, it's a funny way to put it, because Zach has just defined what an n-cycle is, and it's not.
You're going to say this is a three-cycle?
It's nothing to be embarrassed about. It's the notation.
Like just being
one. Oh, like this is a three, this is not like, this might be called three.
It might be called this, but it is, we know, because Zach is just doing this definition. So you have an idea about reading structure?
Yeah. So for the rest of it, and I have an idea for restructuring, for tightening it a bit. One of the issues is that the range is defined, and we don't know why it's being defined.
Exactly. Yeah.
And another issue is that we don't know why you're making this table, what you're talking about with assumptions and ranges as you're doing 1, 2, and 3. And you don't really need these, as far as I can tell, for 1, 2. So another option, instead of doing the table, and instead of doing range here, go ahead and talk about trivial three-value games, but then are you going to do this thing with the evens and odds?
Yes.
Okay. So you can do the same thing. Just do these three as,
so 0x.
This goes back to itself. That's our three cycles.
Well, up to equivalence.
But I don't understand why. So, it doesn't bother me that it's up to equivalence. How would you denote that it's up to equivalence?
No. Put a bracket around it or something? I don't know.
How about, because I mean all of these are up to equivalence.
Well,
more or less.
Yes.
So.
No, well, okay. Okay.
Or something to think about.
Well, then you could put 0, 1, 1, for that matter. It doesn't have to be x, and then it would go up to equivalence. But okay.
Wait.
All right.
And then when you do look at this.
This
case, you can say, well, this just becomes this.
Okay.
And when you look at this
same thing.
Well, not quite, because it depends.
It can
become either this or that, depending on whether x is less than y.
Yeah.
So that leaves us with these two. But these are equivalent.
They are equivalent, exactly.
So we only need to consider this one.
Right.
In order to do it, we're going to consider this thing called range. Range is, and then you can just focus on that. And it'll be, I believe it will be easier for the audience to, I think it will help if you can list out all the cases at the start so that people see everything you're going to address, and then you can address these three by putting in those arrows. And then the other piece that still bothers me is missing is that, so you've got the range decreasing and decreasing, but how do you know that it doesn't decrease down to zero with XXX? What you haven't done is say that 0, 0, 0 comes from XXX and nothing goes into XXX.
Well, it's impossible to get XXX.
But you have to make that point.
I would make that point. This is just something I was saying about the paper, too, that you're somehow dismissing what you call a trivial case as of no interest, but it has a little role to play there.
Maybe I mentioned the whole number line thing, where you can't have XXX because if you think about it, all these numbers are just on a number line, and you can't, like, three numbers on a number line can't be evenly spaced out.
Yeah, I mean, so if you say something like that, to isolate this little part of the dynamics, the 0, 0, 0, and XXX is its own isolated little subsystem there that nothing ever fits, nothing ever goes into.
Okay.
But if you explain it by the number line, you think about it as a number line, your audience doesn't. So if you're going to explain it by a number line, you have to tell us how you're thinking about it.
But I like that. But I like that way of thinking of it. On the other hand, I didn't really think that the number line stuff that you were saying in justifying 4 and 5 up here was very successful, right? Because I was thinking of it as shifting, as offset, as Zach said. It's a matter of this equivalence.
So after investigating some of the interesting properties of the three-value game, the natural question to ask is, do all games have this property where there are some cyclic games and some games that have, you know, fixed points? Or do all games either exhibit only cycling or only fixed points? There are a number of natural extensions. And so an interesting theorem that we proved during the course of this exploration was the fact that all four value games over the integers, in fact, have one cyclic behavior. They all converge to 0, 0, 0, 0. Dilemma that will be required for this result, and then we'll show this result directly, and then we'll generalize this understanding of long-term behavior to the real numbers. To start with, we're going to sort of set up the proof, and then we'll prove a lemma that's required. The proof will, for this result, will require showing that, similar to Yida's proof, we're going to find some invariant on this transformation, and we're going to show that the maximum value in after a transition over the integers will either decrease or stay the same after every operation. And furthermore, we're going to actually show something a little stronger. We're going to show we can set up a sequence of these operations such that we can guarantee the maximum value does, in fact, always decrease. So to start with, we'll start with a lemma. So let S be a game that has entries A, B, C. Sorry, let S be a state, entries A, B, C. So the claim that operating four times on this state will result in a new state, called S4, with all of its entries being even. And we're going to know an even number with an E and an odd number with an O. And to do this, we're going to recall some of the rules for adding and subtracting even numbers, specifically subtracting even and odd numbers. So we have even minus even is an even. Odd minus an odd is an even. We have even minus odd is odd. We have odd minus even is odd. So using the symmetry from the previous problem, from Zach's demonstration of equivalence, we can actually break down the possible types of these ABCDs into evens and odds. So let's look at a few of them now. We could have a case where all the values are even. We could have a case where three of the values are even, and we can place this last odd number anywhere by rotation. We can have a case that there are two evens and two odds, and this one will actually have two different possible setups. Or additionally, we could have even, odd, even, odd. We can have three odds and one even. And finally, we can have four odds. So it's interesting to note that all of these states, sort of, they encompass the universe of what these parities of these states can be. So if we look at what happens when I apply these transitions to each of these states, we get something that looks like the following. So the even odd state and the odd even state. If we do the subtraction, we'll get even minus even is even. It's actually both good, same one. So even minus even or odd minus odd, that's even here. Even minus even or odd minus odd, that's even here. Then odd minus even gives me an odd here, and then even minus odd gives me an odd here. And the same thing for here. So these two, after applying transformation once, will yield even, even, odd, odd. Similarly, let's pull this down. Similarly, we can apply this transition again, and we'll get even, odd, even, odd. And then applying the transition this will yield odd, 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 because all of the pairwise differences are odd. Odd, odd, odd. And then one final application gives even, even, even. So no matter where I start, I'm going to end up at even, even, even. And this is pretty nifty, because by the scaling property of the equivalence, we can actually pull out a factor of 2 out of this and get a game that's equivalent. This will be useful later when we show that we're going to construct a sequence of games that are all equivalent and use this invariant that we have to show that they converge to 0 states. So with this invariant, we're going to show that everything converges to 0, 0, 0, 0. So let S be some state, you know, A, B, C, D, where these are chosen from the positive integers, not negative integers. And consider operating using our operator four times on S. This is going to give us, by this lemma over here, a new state, S prime, or S4, with all even entries. This is equivalent to a game, we'll call it T. Actually, let's call it U. This is equal to, by pulling out a fact of 1/2 u, where this is 1/2 of the entries of S4. And we can let these be a prime, b prime, c prime, d prime. So by removing this factor of 1/2, all of these are guaranteed to be smaller than all of these. Furthermore, this state
this is equal to u, and this is equal to 1 half of s4. All of these entries are smaller than the entries s, and so at least the maximum entry must have decreased. It's a pretty direct result here. And if we continue this inductively, we can reduce the maximum entry for sure after applying four transformations and pulling a factor of 2 out. And because there is a least non-negative integer, this is guaranteed to stop. And it will stop at 0, 0, 0, 0. We're going to show that there exists a non-repeating game. In fact, there exist infinitely many non-repeating games over the real numbers. So, when investigating the real numbers, we need to have a little bit of a better notion of what this T operator actually does. It's nice, so we sort of abstracted this stepping process, but it'd be nice to have a very direct, mechanical way of grinding out the next state from a previous state. And we'd like to basically have this be a linear operator. And unfortunately, the absolute value function is not linear, and so we have to sort of play with it a little bit. So it turns out that suppose I have some state that's in increasing order. So maybe I'll let S be A, B, C, D, with A less than B, less than C, less than D. So it turns out that if we look at T of S, this is equal to the absolute value of B minus A, absolute value of C minus B, absolute value of D minus C, absolute value of A minus D. Well, if we know that this is true, then we can actually remove these absolute values. Since if B is greater than A, then when this condition holds, this state will just be B minus A, this state will be C minus B, this will be D minus C, and then finally this one here, we know A is smaller than D, so this could also just be D minus A. And we can write this, in fact, as a matrix times vector. Let T be the transition matrix, or the transformation matrix. And for this 4x4 case, we're going to have T times the vector is going to be minus 1a plus 1b. Here, and then these are zeros. Here, this is going to be minus 1b plus 1c. These are zeros. This term has minus 1 plus 1. And these are both zeros. And finally, this last term has minus 1a plus 1d. So we're going to call this T4. This is the transition matrix on four values. So this is interesting. We can represent T times some starting state. Let's we can pick anything here, A, B, C, D. And this is going to give us B minus A, C minus B, D minus C. Write it out here. Now, unfortunately, just because this is guaranteed to be in increasing order, we're not guaranteed that this is in increasing order. And so this seems like, oh, we've broken something. Like, this linear operator has a good domain. We can do this nicely, but we're not guaranteed to be able to iterate this process. And so the solution to this problem is to say, well, maybe let's have this be a constant multiple. Can we make it such that this output is always a constant multiple of this input? Because that would maintain the increasing order invariant. And in fact, yes, choose an eigenvector. That will give you a constant multiple here. It'll maintain your scaling and your increasingness. And that's exactly what we want to see. So the goal now is to choose some eigenvector here that has a positive eigenvalue attached to it. Any positive eigenvalue will do. But we have to be careful that we can prove that such a positive eigenvalue exists and is associated with an eigenvector that can be written in increasing order. As it turns out, we'll show in the paper, this is something that you can do. We're going to omit it here for time, but there's a nice little trick you can do with determinants that looks at two diagonal matrices. And so in fact, we can even bound that eigenvalue, which we do in the paper. And that eigenvalue is bounded between 0 and 1. So let lambda n be that eigenvalue. This generates an eigenvector here, which is equivalent to 1 minus lambda n. 1 minus lambda n, 1 plus lambda n, 1 minus lambda n, 1 plus lambda n squared, all the way down to 1
coming down to 1 minus lambda n, 1 plus lambda n to the n minus 2, 1. And so this eigenvector associated with this eigenvalue will actually yield an infinite solution to this problem, because we can put it in front of this transition matrix and apply this transition matrix k times. And each time it's going to be the equivalent, the output is going to be the eigenvalue of the kth power times this eigenvector. So this will yield a non-repeating solution, because we've shown in the paper that this eigenvalue is between 0 and 1. And so you're going to get something that's kind of converging towards 0, 0, 0, 0, but it's never going to actually reach it. This is kind of nifty. As it turns out, this is basically due to the fact that there is no least real number, whereas there is a least non-negative integer. And with that, we'd like to open the floor to questions.
Audiences are really impressed if you can sort of anticipate how things will work out. So you could write down, well, we have this even business. So let's think about the case of even, 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 odd, and trace through what the transition does to that. So you get to even, even, odd, odd, and you get to even, odd, even, odd, and then you get to odd, 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 and then you get to even, even, even. And there's all but one of your four different types of states that you've just gotten to. And so you skip the step of enumerating them, and you get, because they form themselves naturally in front of you. But now you can engage the audience and say, but there is one missing state. Can anyone come up with what it is if you want to? Or you can just say, by the way, now there is one missing state, and it's odd, 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 even, and put it in place, and now you have the whole thing. And so it becomes more dramatic, and you also save in the development.
And I guess it does say enumerating twice, which seems kind of
interesting. Okay. It's more dramatic. It's less kind of, oh, we have this enumeration. It's more dramatic.
Okay.
I thought that in the paper you did a very nice job of motivating the lemma by outlining the proof as a whole. And I think that would work really well in the presentation also. Here, the how you use this went by very, very quickly after presenting the lemma. So you could just start with that instead.
Although I think Matt did. He gave a verbal presentation, right, summary, right after he wrote down the theorem. But it went right over my head.
And I clearly missed it.
So would it be almost more direct to present skeleton proof first, and then the lemma afterwards?
That's what I would suggest.
Could I come back to the notation for equivalence? We were deciding that three lines is sort of a standard thing in arithmetic when you say congruent, modulo, something or other. But there's also the symbol, this squiggle, which is even more common as a notation for equivalence.
The hill wiggle.
Yeah.
So the reason I never use that is because I think of that as asymptotic, like in terms of asymptotics.
Okay.
So like the limit is 1.
It's approximately this.
Yeah.
I would tend to write tilde with a line under it, so almost an equal sign with a line under it for approximately. But and these notations change through mathematics, but the tilde is very common as a notation for equivalence relation.
Yeah, so we could switch.
So you could switch to that. It would be.
And then right here, where the even should be.
That's good. Tilde then. Yeah.
Writing down what you did here. So you said, okay. So what's the matrix? And you wrote out the matrix, and you put the vector next to it, and you rewrote what we already knew, but you wrote it out as vector language here. That was terrific because it brought everybody right up to the moment. It was. That reiteration was, I thought, was really important there, and it was a good, and it felt great. And then it also affirmed, then it puts you in the position that you used to say, but maybe this isn't still going to be increasing. And I thought that was a really successful sequence. And then you made the choice to go soft on the technical stuff about it.
That's more of a timing thing.
That exists and that it's less than one, and I thought that was a wise decision.
Okay.
You could point out that from your, well, even that, never mind.
So part of me wanted to include the characteristic polynomial,
Because it's so sure. cool.
It is kind of clever, yeah. It's so cute.
Oh. It's so cute. But I think you did a great 14 minutes.
Great. Thank you.
So I agree that the development worked really well. If I were to stop listening for a moment to think and then look at the board to try and figure out what was going on, there's no way
yeah.
I would be able to figure it out.
Yeah.
So do write more on the board without messing up the wonderful development you've got.
Yeah, I think that's right. I mean, practice, think about the disposition of things on the board. You can see you sort of have a habit of writing random places and random things, and you can overcome that by planning a little bit.
It can be helpful to actually sketch out what you're going to put on the boards, and then you can look at that sketch and ask yourself, if I were to stop thinking, listening for a moment, would I be able to tell what's going on?
Okay. Great. That's a great project.
Thank you.